agreed to go for this session. Really, sir, thank you very much. And a warm welcome on behalf of Odisha State Open University. Today's topic is on introduction to voluntary action in rural development. Here you will understand how a simple connotation or a concept will transform into a process of practical implication on the real development of a rural community. However, without wasting much of time, I would request Dr. Daniel sir to carry forward this process of deliberation. Thank you all once again. Over to Dr. Daniel sir. Sir, please go ahead.
Thank you, Dr. Rehman. I think someone is presenting. I don't know.
Please, everyone, all the learners, kindly.
No. Someone is making a presentation, so I will use this. Good morning, everyone. Dr. Rehman and friends. It's a great pleasure for me being here and talking to you all about the voluntary sector and the challenges and how it has emerged and how it's emerging as also an organization in India. It's a reputed organization. Many of these organizations are silently actually working. As I was told that I will actually speak for an hour and then we'll also have some conversation. Let me tell you, I'm not a doctor, so I've done my social work, master's, and then I've studied some time in Irma, and then some of this experience that I have gained last 3 decades of working in NGO sector, and also international agency, NGO sector, humanitarian agency, working at abroad and working here, has actually strengthened my own experience. That much I can say. And what I will do, I will take you through a small presentation. Hope I'm audible and you can hear me. And I will also be happy if you can ask me sometimes, stop me if I'm very fast in saying something, or you want me to be a little slower. So I will do that. So I'm not also I do teach sometime, but mostly like this in some kind of. So I'll be taking through my screen and the presentation I'll be making now. So that is here. So I hope all of you can see my screen now. If someone can tell me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
It's showing.
Okay. Great. Is it visible?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Fantastic. Yes, I'm visible.
Yeah, okay, thank you. So basically, I'll be introducing to this concept of voluntary action. I'll be taking it through. I'll speak about the voluntarism, then also how the entire process of voluntary action has emerged in India particularly, and also some examples in Western countries. And then I'll take you through the kind of voluntary sector in India, few examples and types of organization, its structures and all. So I will actually take you through my presentation, then we will discuss. To start with this voluntary sector, I would actually focus more on this. What is this voluntarism that we are talking about? Voluntarism, we always see that people volunteer for certain cause, they devote some time. And it was also in 16th century, I think that's the time that it was mostly very popular that people used to offer their service to military purpose, because that was the war, Second World War and other, I think people have seen. A lot of soldiers died and people wanted to volunteer there. And this is an organization which came up Young Men's Christian Association in the United States was first started, people volunteer, and then the emergence of Young Women's Christian Association, who came together to do some kind of reach out to people who are in distress and help each other. Similarly, basically because of that, the war, that people were actually disturbed and they wanted to help. The soldiers were actually on the borders or on the frontiers. So women have actually volunteered to provide supplies to the army. So there are people always on the history, like, you know, I'll take you through also in Indian context later on, but always we have seen how people have volunteered for social cause, for anything that the people can come together for any crisis. If the society is facing, if there are any problem the society is facing, the people come together and they devote some time. The principle of donating time, energy, for the benefit of other people, when we see in the community, is a very responsible kind of personal kind of action we demonstrate many times. Then we don't look at for any financial reward. We try to help them. We take out our time. We don't, sometimes people are also committed for doing voluntary kind of work. Volunteering is also a renowned for skill development, and it's often intended to promote goodness or improve human quality of life. I think volunteers who are less skilled, who are actually gifted with more skill, I think sometimes they also transfer the skill, and people how they teach people also through knowledge, through skill, through kind of right kind of attitude. So volunteerism also, people sometimes help each other. It's a peer learning. Also, I can say it's a human learning that happens. Then what is volunteerism that we actually say? Volunteerism is the practice of providing time and skill for the benefit of other people. That's already I said how, if you have a skill, if you have a talent, how you are going to use it for others. And without any expecting any favor, any money, any benefit, so you are actually providing some support or wherever there is a need that you are actually providing that. It's mostly the cause is more important than the financial benefit the volunteers they look at. In an employment related context, volunteerism is concerned with the methods and tools employees use to support employees that want to volunteer. Also, increasingly we see that, I will come back to this again in more detail, like in very, I think most of the companies or the corporates today, they are also encouraging their employees also how they will also volunteer, because they all work like a machine in a corporate sector, and they are being encouraged to do some kind of social work, some kind of reaching out to people who are in need of any support. So that is now, I think, when we see that increasingly, various employers are also adopting, it's also a good practice. We see the areas of volunteerism. Many volunteers are responsibly, specifically trained in the areas they work, such as medicine, education, or emergency rescue. Some people are trained, doctors are trained, some are actually teachers, some are actually rescue workers, or you have those who are actually engaged in disasters, and all they're trained. So these volunteers actually provide their work additionally that they what they do officially, but also they reach out to people and provide support. These are all professionals. We also say that they have certain professionalism and they want to actually deliver that to others. So that we see. The others serve on an age whenever there is a need basis, natural disaster. Many of you must have volunteered also during natural disaster, going out, helping people in your basti or your society or your colonies, wherever you're living. I think people actually come together. I think people, they spontaneously, they come together if there are any crisis happens. And this people come forward, young people and other people, they come forward to actually give their energy and help other people. This is basically we see in natural disaster, whenever there's a humanitarian crisis, that we see people volunteer, they come forward to help other people. In military context, a volunteer is someone who joins his armed forces. of their own wish, they are not being recruited. I think that conscripted means that they are not recruited, or there is no formal kind of recruitment take place. But in Western countries, many places, that after your graduation, after you study, you undergo some kind of voluntary military training, so that you can serve the country whenever there is a need. And many people, they go, like we have National Cadet Corps in India. We have various such kind of institutional arrangement in India, where actually you can have a entry point kind of recruitment and experience of serving the nation. So that is one facilities we have. We have national service volunteers, and Government of India has a volunteership, and people also go for volunteer in civil defense, where actually people go and so we have that kind of concept, like how people go and serve in military, like in civil defense, or non-commissioned kind of officers. Like you see many people, they commission in civil and non-civil, in civil and military establishments. Like we see the, what are the types of volunteers that we generally see? A service learning program. I think most of the school or colleges that we say that is practically how we learn from society, how we go out, and a part of your curriculum that also you have to go interact with the community and come back school. They initiate some kind of voluntary program, that those who are actually studying medicine, they go out, they perform some work. So engineering student also, they have a time, identify themselves with the people who are in need, they go and interact. So basically, like whichever subject you are, but also we know that the human behavior, how you actually learn from others, how you understand people's issues. So that's important. And many places, like we have in our academic institution, people go out and study. And social work also, we have seen that how people go out and also do their project work. Sometimes some people do it very seriously, and they immerse themselves with the community. So that also we have seen. Then again, the second is the skill-based volunteering. How someone is having skill, and how we can leverage special skills and talent of individual. How we can get a special trait. Somebody's painter, that painter can go to school, teach children how to paint. Someone who knows a little bit of social media, or doing his film, or using a camera, any creative kind of work, can go and also talk to student and transfer the skills. There are virtual volunteering, that e-learning, cyber service, telementoring, telemedicine also there. I think a lot of. And we are actually now, after the COVID-19, mostly we are into this world, the virtual kind of world, where we actually are talking to each other and also learning from each other's experience. So this is one area, e-learning is also improving today. And people have time. People can give time to some kind of other kind of processes. And that is quite useful. Then environmental volunteering, that mostly that conservation related, the environmental management related, how people can actually help in conserving environment. People are actually going cleaning up the beach, and they're also going and also wherever the Olive Ridley, that I've seen that many people, they volunteer, go actually protect the environment. Some people are actually very organized way volunteers. In a particular time, they go and do the work. Now the volunteerism is actually increasing because of the social media. People are coming together for a cause. People are going out and also for a cause, they are actually joining hands. So this is one kind of thing has actually improved after this technology has come and people are actually doing it. Then volunteering in emergency, I've already said natural disaster, man-made disaster, other emergency. I think this is quite very old kind of response. That the human response that we all have, and people actually go and work. Volunteering in school, like, you know, someone want to teach in a school, that they can also go. They could be a guide. They could be also, like, you know, provide other creative learning. Corporate volunteering, I've already said how employers particularly volunteer program, like many of the big companies like TCS or Infosys, or you can say any big corporate agency, they have a course that they have to go and spend some time with the community. I know Tata Administrative Service, I know Tata Company, they have their own administrative service. So every person who is recruited has to spend 2 months in a village. So they go and study people. Whoever goes to appear for the civil services, they are also have some time to spend with the community and do some volunteering work, come up and help the community. So these are the things are there, part of our, and now it's growing now. I think because of the issues are also, like, you know, becoming complex, you need more people, and we have more educated people today. We have more technocrat today. We have more kind of, you know, professionals today who should go out and also help others who are less privileged. So that is what one area. Then community voluntary work, we see that community services in your locality where you are living, if something happens, if anything, like, you know, we know the puja pandals during the Dasera that we see, people spontaneously come together in religious activities. They come together in various religious gathering that we see people, they come they contribute. And volunteerism is also, like, you know, it's very constructed in our like religious work, that we all work for a better cause. Charity or this kind of, when we see that any charity or anything that is woven into our own religious, cultural kind of ethos. Like, you know, when we say practice of giving and sharing, also known as zakat, is compulsory in Islam that people actually donate. People help people in Hinduism or Jainism that we see daan is a major kind of thing that we give daan. We give money, we dole out money, we help people. And kar seva is actually Sikhism, that if when you see that Sikhism, we have kar seva, people actually do voluntary work. You see that wherever there is natural disaster happen, the Sikh groups, they come and they start langar. Langar is a place where people, hungry people, they go and they actually have their food there free of cost. And they serve the community. I think it's everywhere in India or international, wherever you go, you have this langar is very famous for people go there and have their food. Again, sadaq is voluntary, like, you know, in Islam, is also says, thus once when 10% of your, thus once is basically 10% of the total of your income in Christianity, and also Judaism, and also, like, you know, you have this system of, like, you know, 10% of your income that should go for the underprivileged people, who help others. So in our entire kind of, you know, religious practice, religious teaching, we have this, like, you know, how we are going to reach out to people, help other people from your income, from your social work, do some good work. So we also say that most of our religious scripture, these good works are also given more priority. And this is really in all the religious thing, people are encouraged to help and do some good work for people. Voluntary action also we have seen from the pre-independence time, that people started constructing temple, dharmasala, andan. I think people who are hungry, they are being provided food. Like I said already, like, you know, you have langar, you have many temples, they feed food, and many places, religious festival, they provide food. Sramdan was a very, like, you know, many people must have done in their life, like, you know, going out. It's a community work that you actually give your labor. The dignity of labor, you feel through actually doing some community work, constructing a road, doing a plantation, many such work, people come together, they come cleaning up, Swachh Bharat, you can see, has become more popular also by this Shramdaan. People came forward and also started giving their shram or labor to do that. Vastradaan has become people actually donate clothes to the needy. And today, one of the organizations which is very famous in India, Goonj. Goonj is actually doing the Vastradaan and very famous in India. I think this NGO has been working this noble work. Gyandan is also there. Many places that we, many institutions we see. Or during the early days also, many places where the Gyandan was actually given free of cost to the people. And people have got this teaching free of cost by the people from the community, from the religious institutions. I think they also run schools, institutions. So basically the Gyan, the Shram, the Ann, and sheltering people who are in need. And it has gone beyond the traditional way of looking at the charity or charity work in India. There are also social action. What is charity and what is social action, that we could also see whether we had any social action in the past. I think Arya Samaj was actually formed in 1875, actually looking into the issues within the society during those days and how the reforms could be done. Brahmo Samaj was actually also very old, Raja Ramon Rai. Everyone we have read about the kind of reforms he brought in on sati and empowering women. Then we see that the entire Gandhian movement was actually based out of the basic principle of selfless services. The best way to find what Gandhi said, and I quote, the best way to find oneself is to lose yourself in the service of others. How you could actually dedicate yourself, how we could also do something for people. Then the Mahatma Gandhi talked about Antodaya. Antodaya is a concept, the last person, how the last person in our society should be empowered, should be developed, should also get all privileges like other things. And talisman, I think we know Mahatma Gandhi has given that whenever you are in doubt, you think about a person that you have seen in somewhere, and whatever now you are doing, or whatever we are now studying, or whatever I'm doing, whether your work is going to help that person, or whether your work will uplift that person, that is what the talisman Gandhi has given. So the social action is basically you bring in certain positive energy, some action to actually reform the society and the evils whatever there in the society, any discriminatory practices are there in the society, any ill effect of certain things are there, or how you can have a equal rights, how you could have a better kind of society. So basically everything is, there is a vision to look at how actually a society could be more equitable, and how you can have equal rights, how you can see that there will not be any discriminatory practices. So these are basically the pillars for the social action that people have come, like Mahatma Gandhi or Raja Ramon Roy, or very lot of reform being brought by these people. My next, will be mostly on non-profit organizations, or lot of terminology we use for what is NGOs, or different kind of terminology we use for voluntary organization. But I'm starting with non-profit organization. That is how it was actually being termed initially. This is collective of volunteers who form groups to help people in need. So you know that earlier we found people came together to help people, or help people in disaster, or in distress or provide some support. So these people, they formed a collective. Slowly they came together, they formed a collective. Like, you know, in US, they found that to promote cultural, social, and educational cause, I think in the history of United States, they came together to do some work other than the government. In colonial time, American, they wanted to have a self-governing nation. And who didn't trust government involvement most of the time. Because they said, look, no, other than the government, there should be a civil society. There should be people, they should have a body which will actually work closely with the government, but it will not be known as government. And this body will actually address the social and other problems. Charity was seen as a religious duty, and people in need could rely on their neighbors or the community to help them. So even various religious body, they came together and they said they will form an organization for ensuring health practices, providing health services, providing education services. And we know that after independence, many of these missionary organizations which came to India, or there are also organizations which we had in India, Ramakrishna Mission and various organizations who came. These are the early days of Gandhian organizations and ashrams. Many, I think we have seen that this kind of organization started emerging for doing a very constructive or institutional based organization, which are not a government organization. So those institutions which are not part of government, then people started calling them non-profit organization, and they've not geared up for any profit. They were not aimed for any profit. So most of the work that they have been started doing is basically a selfless work. And also they don't generate profit. In India, nationally we have, or internationally we have organizations above, other than government, are actually profit making or non-profit making, the companies which are there. But non-governmental organizations are non-profit organization, also known as a non-profit organization. Then you heard about voluntary organization. Mostly in India, we heard about mostly as a voluntary organization or non-governmental organization is a legally constituted organization created by natural or legal persons. Then I think slowly people started thinking that this should, all organization or voluntary bodies, voluntary organizations should have their own identity. And this identity would actually be legal, or initially they started forming this organization as non-organization, but slowly they started, the government came up, government wanted to monitor, government wanted to actually give them some kind of legal status. So these organizations are also legally constituted. In many jurisdictions, these types of organizations are also called civil society organizations. Voluntary organization in India, largely non-governmental organizations which are not part of government. And then in many jurisdictions, civil society organizations are referred. But civil society organizations are beyond the NGOs. Civil society today, or everyone, they are the media, the NGOs, they are the writers, they are the students. So all people are actually part of civil society. So many times we actually interchangeably, we use NGO vis-a-vis civil society, but civil society is larger than NGO, or it's a combination of various organizations. So there is also sometimes we name these organizations interchangeably. Definition of NGOs, then what? What is that? I think when the World Bank came, the NGO terminology has been hugely used. NGOs are defined by the World Bank as private organizations that pursue activities to relieve suffering, promote the interest of the poor, protect the environment, provide basic social services, or undertake community development. So this is what, when the World Bank came, World Bank was, those days are seen as a key development player, providing financial assistance to the government. But the World Bank then thought like, no, things are not happening, because the core of the developmental work is how to mobilize people, how to go and do a realistic plan, how the bottom-up planning, how the bottom-up work can be taken up, so that in many development programs, then they find that NGOs are mostly promoted also during those days. I think the World Bank and other organizations, they actually advocated the larger role of NGOs internationally. Non-governmental organization, again, the phrase non-governmental organization only came into popular use with the establishment of the United Nations organization in 1945. 1945 also, with the formation of United Nations, with the provision in Article 71 of Chapter 10 of the United Nations for a consultative role of organization, because it's the heads of the government who are part of the United Nations, and United Nations has various kind of its subgroups or ministries, which are actually bodies, you can call. There are socio-economic, there are also peace. So you have different chapters which works in United Nations. And there is a separate chapter where actually United Nations provide the NGOs as a consultative role. I think United Nations also consults the organization or NGOs working in different places. In our constitution also, we see that Article 19(1)(c), to right to form association, you can form association, you can organize. Right to organization is also a part of your fundamental right. Article 43, which highlights the state saving and endeavor to promote cooperatives in rural area. What is this cooperative then? We had a cooperative movement in India, and then government also said how self-help cooperative groups could actually come. Then also current list in entry 28 mentions about charities and charitable institution, religious endowments, religious institution also, concurrent list of the state and center. But there are mentioning about endowments and some institutions which are exist. But these two important constitutional obligations are actually the right to form association, how people can come together, form their own association. Types of legal entries for the NGOs, I think, do have any? So many of these organizations are registered. They're registered under the Societies Act of 1860. 1860 was actually much older. I think still we have. Then we have a Trust Act, Indian Trust Act of 1882. The non-profit companies, according to Section 25, even companies have also the character of non-profit. Many organizations also registered under the Companies Act. Many CSR bodies today in corporate are actually registering under this. Lot of research bodies are also doing. Cooperative society, which is actually very famous, it's very older. Like how the farmers cooperative societies or the milk producers cooperative society that we know are very successful. Then multi-state, I think some cooperative society, their area of operation is maybe a particular area, but multi-state cooperative society, Trade Unions Act is there, religious societies are there. And there are many, many kind of legal entities you'll find. So the type of voluntary bodies today are different. Like we heard about NGOs who actually work is a national level. Their jurisdiction is maybe one panchayat or in a block. INGOs are mostly international non-governmental organizations. CBOs are actually community-based organizations. Like community-based organizations, we say that youth clubs or any farmers organization or any small organization that we have in a village. Civil society organization, I've already said, many of these organizations coming together, maybe they are known as civil society organizations, but today also NGOs are also called a civil society organization. Self-help group, I think we have a very huge self-help group movement in Odisha or in India, and Mission Shakti is also in Odisha. We have this self-help group, I think, large lakhs of women are part of this in India, in Orissa. Federations, we have many organizations, they come together, they formed a federation. Then in every village, we have committees, small committees. These are all non-statutory kind of bodies which are not registered. Then you have people's movement. People's movement are basically like an anti-displacement movement, anti-corruption movement, right to information, lot of rights-based kind of people's movement we have. So their roles are also different, which we see. Basically, these are the roles that we see NGOs. They do service delivery, provide supplement, complement government in providing services in some needy areas, in emergencies, and provide support to the community. Mobilization is a key work that they do, community participation, ensuring community participation. Then you have advocacy. Advocacy is basically today in a world when wherever there is any law being formulated by central government or state government, if the law is going to make an adverse kind of impact on people, people advocate against those laws. Then they are also working in the social safety valve role. Suppose there are something, corruption is happening, something wrong is happening, something in the society. So they have the safety valve. Also the rage issues, the voice against those injustice happening. Proper action is taken. Then also they look at the government, improving government performance, how actually the government works, whether government is working properly, whether government is not working, how efficient is the government, whether the delivery, government delivery systems are good, whether they're providing quality deliverable. So these are also another role that NGOs see, that how they also monitor. Then innovation and experimentation. Another area is that NGOs are actually largely working on this, innovating new kind of techniques, new agriculture processes, new technology in education, new technology in health, experimentation, research, a lot of other things they do. They bring out the issues and they advocate. So these are the roles that I see that largely the NGOs they do in India and also elsewhere. Then what is the key activities? I think this is a role that that we see that NGOs are playing. What are the key activities they do on the ground? As I said already, the delivery services are one of the key organizational they do, essential humanitarian development, and they do social work, advocacy, analysis, and awareness. I think raising as a voice for people and acting as a voice for people, both on a representative and self-appointed basis. They represent people, they advocate for people, they help people to raise their voices, researching, analyzing, and informing the public about issues, mobilizing citizens' action through media campaigns, people do, and other forms of activism and lobbying business leaders to and policymaker. So starting from ill effect of any policy or any business that's happening to violation of rights of children, women, elderly. So various people, I think these are the voice civil NGOs are raising today. Brokerage is basically acting as an intermediary between different sectors and groups. So they actually act instead of, I couldn't find anything, but this is how they actually help bridging with other entities or other service providers or other intermediary. Conflict resolution, acting as a mediator and facilitator wherever there are conflict arising on certain issues between communities or among communities. So they try to provide counseling, they try to provide also domestic kind of problems, domestic violence is also coming up. So they provide also some kind of counseling role. They provide psychosocial counseling, family counseling, and any conflict which are arising. Capacity building is one of the core areas also, like we see NGOs are actually working today, providing education, training and information skills. Capacity building is done for government, for community member, for Panchayati Raj people. So these are, they do. And then also, they serve as a watchdog. I already said how they also act as a watchdog or third party, independent auditors. We say social audit. Social audit is a major component which is now emerging. Right to information, that that it's come out in India. And then they use those tools for making the government more transparent, demanding the government to be more transparent, and also their performance to the people. Changing roles of NGOs that we have seen, from 1800 to 1900, mostly we have seen social reforms have come up, social religious movement have emerged. I think this is the time, elevation of poverty and social discrimination, some kind of social discrimination have come, the peasantry kind of issues, which are actually being was very focused. This is the phase that we could see what happened to NGOs. And 1900 to 1947, I think this is the time the freedom movement was actually on its peak. And this is the time also there are emergence of missionaries have happened in India, rise of volunteers because of the national movement, freedom movement, rise of CBO, small organizations have come up. Self-sufficiency is actually, Charkha was the symbol of self-sufficiency, which Mahatma Gandhi has actually advocated, and the economic support, self-sufficiency. I think these are the phase that was well known up to this pre-independent era. Then this era is from 1947 to 2000. I think it's wonderful. Here actually you see a lot of vibrant, democratic, as well as development processes taken new shapes. Then the constitution came up, the national building was actually the priority, the relief work, a central social welfare board was formed, Panchayati Raj institutions introduced in India as a grassroots kind of democratic bodies and development bodies. Then a lot of international NGOs have come to the picture during this time. Participatory development and governance was actually promoted, how it's important to bring in people to be part of your development process, from planning, from execution, from auditing. Most of the work is key for people. Then you have planning commission during this period has actually emphasized the larger role of NGOs and the better coordination for development. I think we have seen that the five-year plans from all the five-year plan till the 14th five-year plan that we have seen the scope was created for NGOs to be part of the development process for India. Then 2000 onwards, I think the movement, the 90s or 1999, the globalization or the liberalization process happened in India. Slowly also the NGOs, they started, getting into a newer role. The CSR came up, corporate social responsibility, more as a policy advocacy came because of this globalization. There are issues of poor people was in danger. There are actually their resources was actually in danger. So there was a market which was becoming powerful. And NGOs started actually raising the voices of poor people were actually being discriminated by the corporate bodies. I think this is a time we see that more and more policy level initiative was done. And this is a time also we've seen that the coming together of international agency together as a solidarity body to work on global issues. It's not only remain as a national issue or the local issue. So the local and global issues were actually taken together with the solidarity of various organizations globally all over the world. I think this was a golden phase. I can say that when 1947 was a rebuilding phase, I think 2000 was actually really looking into that how to minimize the discriminatory practices or the unequal kind of processes which was happening in our society and due to the wrong policies. You can see that NGOs in India is very old. I found this one actually. What is the number of NGOs are there? It's 1.5 million. 1.5 million is 15 lakhs NGOs, generally we are talking about. And there are rural-based, urban-based, there are registered, unregistered. These statistics are old, so I'm not playing out this one. There are also religious organizations, communities, social services, they do education. There are some people are in education, sports and culture, health, and in other places. So I thought that this I can show you. Now, I would come to this, what actually NGOs have contributed in India. I think one of the contributions that we still see is that their contribution for the safeguarding and saving the environment and forest. I think Chipko movement, we all know how the love for our environment, protecting our forest was actually the major issue. Also the displacement issue has come up in the core, because this is the time the debate started whether you need the development and debate, and also should you displace, should people have to sacrifice, then ensuring people's participation. Participatory development process was actually the gift or the contribution of NGOs. How local people, how people on the ground would actually participate for development. Education, it's a quality education or the better education, and early childhood care education, school education, and also advocating to have right to education in India is one of the, I could say, is a major contribution. Then people with disability, their rights, advocating their rights and bringing out legislation for people of disability rights, child protection, child rights. So you can see that many of food security, the new Food Security Act came, the gender and women's rights, the new thinking have come into the equality of society, and particularly those people were being suffering. Food security was large, hunger and the debate, and also solution to that, like in the Food Security Act in India, you can say, the Narega Act, you can say, these are all the outcome of the long struggle and long advocacy done by NGOs and civil society and activists in India. Then the care and support for the elderly people, I can name HelpAge India is actually working wonderfully. Child protection, when you see that there are organizations like CRY, which are actually doing wonderful work. Emergency response, I think this is one area where actually NGOs and other people have brought in new knowledge, new expertise, new professional expertise into this, that how we could actually, and I remember that I was part of 1999 super cyclone and in Orissa, and now we could see that how it has transformed completely the kind of technology, the kind of response, immediate response, faster response program that's happening. And this, a lot of NGOs have contributed hugely for this work. Then workers' rights we are talking about, and today the whole world is looking into the rights of the migrant worker, and which is my favorite subject, and I have been working on this issue for long, and basically to see that what's happening to this migrant worker at the time of this COVID crisis. And we have seen that how they are being actually they're neglected, and there are how they're actually facing the problem. Agriculture, farming, the non-utilization of chemical fertilizer and kind of organic kind of. These are all in the budget and analysis, which one today government, NGOs are also getting into budgetary area. They do budget analysis. They tell government, look, you have to put certain amount of budget for education, social sector, and that has been there. And that is how India can actually emerge. So that was my last presentation, and to basically like to end my my talk on this. Now the civil society organizations are actually playing very pivotal role in various sector and various sectors they are in. And because we have large organization and organization with a lot of knowledge and expertise are actually working. And the newer challenges are also emerging in India and the globally. So here I'll stop, Dr. Rehman, and if you can take it forward, if you have any questions or answer that we could start addressing it. Thank you very much for listening.
Thank you very much, sir. Sir, बहुत धन्यवाद सर. सर आई एम सरप्राइज्ड दैट यू हैव मेड अ सच अ वंडरफुल प्रेजेंटेशन एंड द टाइम इज सो मच लिमिटेड एंड यू हैव ट्राइड टू मेक द टाइम वैल्यूएबल. सर मैंने समस्त को जानना चाहूंगी जे डॉक्टर डैनियल सर को मु
नो डॉक्टर डॉक्टर रहमान आई एम नॉट अ डॉक्टर आई एम नॉट अ पीएचडी या या
सर लेट मी क्लेरिफाई टू गेट इनटू इर्मा इन द फील्ड ऑफ रूरल डेवलपमेंट और रूरल मैनेजमेंट is sometimes more prestigious or more acceptable than having PhD, sir. So since you sometimes you are a student of IRMA, that speaks today's presentation through today's presentation, and it can be justified ki your what you call caliber is presented to all the students that we have to learn much more things in due course of time. মানে যেটা কি বহুত ভাল ভাবে কহবা চাহুচি স্যার এত বিজি রয়েছে ওড়িশা টেলিভিশন ওটিভি সন্ধ্যা সাতটা প্রাইম টিভি পরে ইউ উইল ফাইন্ড ওমি জেনারেল স্যার প্রেজেন্টেশন ডিসকশন ডেলিবরেশন সেট চালিথায় এন্ড ইট ওয়াজ ভেরি হেক্টিক সেটা মানে চাল্লা পরে তাকু যেতে বড় আপনার মিডিয়ারে কুমার ইট ইজ রিফ্লেক্টিং দি ভয়েস অফ দি পিপল অফ ওড়িশা তো সেইটা কলা পরে স্যার মতো কালে যে কহিলে যে কোন মু কইবি মুকুল স্যার ইউ আর দ ফ্লোর ইজ ইয়োর্স আফটার আই এম গোইং টু ইন্ট্রোডিউস দ ফ্লোর ইজ ইয়োর্স আপনি যাহা কইবে এন্ড আই এম সারপ্রাইজ হি হ্যাজ গিভেন সচ এ লিডারশিপ ইন সচ এ ডিটেইল ম্যানার সে বড় বড় কইছেন স্যার আমি কিছু কোয়েশ্চেন্স আসছি সে কোয়েশ্চেন্স কু মু স্যার টিকে আপনাকে শেয়ার করিবি তো পচারিছেন যে হোয়াট আর দি ডিফারেন্স বিটুইন এনজিও এন্ড জিও এন্ড হোয়াট আর দি মেইন অবজেক্টিভস অফ এ এনজিও
There are differences. It's a government organization and another is a non-governmental organization. In government organization also you find NGOs today because NGOs are more flexible and the government agency you see that they are actually there are a lot of processes, bureaucratic processes are there. Government re apan DRDA jodi dekhibe, DRDA is one which is a non-governmental organization. It's registered under 1860 registered act. So there are some if you can see the watershed society or any small society or ORMAS you can take Odisha Rural Marketing, these are all actually formed within the government setup, but they are all registered NGOs only but managed by government. Ab baki jo NGOs hai they are actually self run but NGOs are government are actually run by their own system.
স্যার মু আউটসাইড অ্যাড করে চাইবি অশোক কুমার পাড়ে পচারিছন্তি মানে লেট মি ক্লারিফাই এনজিও কহিলে বা ভলেন্টারি অর্গানাইজেশন কহিলে ইট ইজ সমথিং লাইক ইন্টারডিপেন্ডেন্ট আপনার ট্রায়াঙ্গুলেশন যদি করবে গোটে জায়গায় গভর্নমেন্ট অছি গোটে জায়গায় পিপল অছন্তি আর গোটে জায়গায় নিহাতি ইউ নিড দি হেল্প অফ নন গভর্নমেন্টাল অর্গানাইজেশনস আনলেস এন্ড আনটিল দেয়ার আর দি এফর্টস ফ্রম থ্রি ট্রায়াঙ্গলস গভর্নমেন্ট দ্বারা নন গভর্নমেন্ট দ্বারা আর পিপল বা লোকালাইজ people those who are involved in the process of development jodi tin jananko support na rahe tahale apno you can't think about any kind of development maybe in the urban development or in the field of rural development.
Yeah
sir, we have next question. What are the differences between NGO, non profit organization and voluntary organization?
Yeah, non, these are all same, the name is only changed. Non profit organization, NGOs, civil society organization, I think you said.
Yes,
civil society organizations are different because here we are actually naming everyone as the same. Civil society organizations are those all organizations coming together, like the student, the press, the media, the NGOs, the intellectual, the academic, all are actually known in India as the civil society. It's a society, it's a civil society, which includes also NGO. But NGOs are different. NGO basically like non-governmental organization or voluntary organizations, they are the same. They're the same registered bodies. Either they're registered independently or registered by government or registered by the corporate bodies. Corporates are also having their own registered organization. So the three are different. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. I could also request all the learners, apna jodi kichhi haba practical questions pachale far better rahiba, kahina sir practical questions are basically acquainted. These are theoretical, apna bahire pai paribe. There is one learner pacharichanti, Rajaram Malik. Sir, is it true that approximately 1 crore NGOs have registered in India? Then he is asking, what is the process of NGO registration? What is FCRA register in NGOs?
Okay. Let me write this again. If you can repeat this thing, I can't remember. One is 1 crore NGO. Then
1 crore NGOs have registered in India. What is the process of registration?
Okay.
And the next one is, what is FCRA register in NGOs?
Okay. And anything that you can say that I can note it down. Who has questioned this one?
This is Rajaram Malik. Rajaram. He is also asking, sir, is your esteemed organization working in Odisha directly or indirectly?
Okay.
Sir, this is the question, sir.
Any other question?
No, sir.
Okay. So it's Rajaram Malik. It's an interesting question. There are 1 crore NGO. I don't know actually, because even when PCOs used to operate, PCO, the telephone call booth, they were also registered under 1860. The DRDAs are also registered under 1860. A youth club is registered under 1860. SAG is also registered under 1860. So the nature of organizations are different. And many organizations today are registered under 1860 Society Act. That's the reason many times government says a huge number mushrooming organizations are actually registered. So that is, there is no classification of what kind of NGOs are there. So that is what it creates a lot of confusion sometimes. Then process of registration is actually you have a district society, every district. And this district society, there is a prescribed format. Registered of society is there at the district. You want to work in a district, you have to go to the register of societies. And you have to give the bylaws, the constitution of the organization, and you can register them. And also you can register at the state level. If you want to work in an entire state, so you can register in Cuttack. So there is a register of society at the state level, which will allow you to operate. So the jurisdiction matters. If it is a within district, that you can go to register your organization at the district level. So the district register office is there. And also you want to register organization under Trust Act, that also you can do. So one is the Registered of Society or Trust Act, you can register the same. Then FCRA is basically like Foreign Currency Regulation Act. Foreign Currency Regulation Act is actually will help you to register with the Ministry of Home Affairs through the collector. There is a prescribed form online, you can do that. And while after registration, there will be certain formalities, your organization will be will be asked to submit certain documents, financial document, and then you'll be given a particular number, FCRA number, to receive foreign currency from abroad. If you really want to get money from abroad, so FCRA or Foreign Currency Regulation Act will help you to get the foreign funding. Now the FCRA has been made very stringent, very difficult, and large number of people were actually blacklisted or not actually maintaining certain statutory kind of documents and compliances. So many organizations. Our organization is an international organization. I work in an organization called Edit Action, and I look after now currently, we are working in various countries, and we are into research, we are into child rights, we are into education, and we are into skill development program in India, in 7 states. In Orissa, my unit actually looks after the various work related to informal works, the research, emergency work, and also like, you know, the migration that we are talking about, that's my specialization. I work on migration and refugees issues in South Asia. So that's where I work. That's the reason I'm a little busy, what Dr. Rehman was telling. And I can also send you the kind of the 3 to 4 article that I've written on the recent issue on the COVID-19 and migration issues. I can say it through Dr. Rehman. Yeah.
Sir, thank you very much. So first of all, let me clarify to all my learners. They come to get a lot of confusion. Probably this was the confusion with me also. We are always discussing ki 1 crore NGOs have been registered in India. Really, because of the Society Registration Act 1860, you could see ki a institution just like DRDA, District Rural Development Agency under Panchayat Department, is also a part of 1860 Act. So, ethe sabu sanstha samaj jivan samasta jemse jodito achanti samaste 1860 Act anusar achanti. ଯେଉଁଟାକୁ ଆମେ ଭାବି ନେଉଛୁ କି ସବୁ ହେଇଗଲେ NGO ସୋ ଇୟର୍ ୱି ହାଭ୍ ଟୁ ଥିଙ୍କ୍ ଓଭର୍ ଇଟ୍ କି କେଉଁଟା NGOରେ ଇନଭଲ୍ଭ ଅଛନ୍ତି କେଉଁମାନେ NGOରେ ଇନଭଲ୍ଭ ନାହାନ୍ତି ଆଉ ସେଥିପାଇଁ ୱି ହାଭ୍ ଟୁ ମେକ୍ ଏ କ୍ଲିୟର୍ କଟ୍ ଡିମାର୍କେସନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଡିଫରେଣ୍ଟ ଅର୍ଗାନାଇଜେସନ୍ ଡିଫରେଣ୍ଟ ଇନଷ୍ଟିଚ୍ୟୁସନ୍ସ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଦ ଲାଷ୍ଟ ପାର୍ଟ ଯେଉଁଟା ସାର୍ କହିଲେ ରାଜରଞ୍ଜ ପଚାରିଥିଲେ କି ସାର୍ ହ୍ୱାଟ୍ ଆବାଉଟ୍ ୟୋର୍ ଅର୍ଗାନାଇଜେସନ୍ ଲେଟ୍ ମି ଗିଭ୍ ଦିସ୍ କାଇଣ୍ଡ ଅଫ୍ କ୍ଲାରିଫିକେସନ୍ ଟୁ ଅଲ୍ ମାଇ ଲର୍ନର୍ସ ଉମି ଡାନିଏଲ ସାର୍ ଇଜ୍ ଦି ଲିଡ୍ ସ୍ପିକର୍ ୱାଜ୍ ଦି ଲିଡ୍ ସ୍ପିକର୍ ଇନ୍ ଓଡ଼ିଶା ବିକାଶ କନ୍କ୍ଲେଭ୍ 2018 ଯୋଉଥିରେ କି ଭାଇସ୍ ଚେୟାରମ୍ୟାନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ପ୍ଲାନିଂ କମିଶନ ଅଫ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ୱାଜ୍ ଦେୟାର ଟୁ ଡିସ୍କସ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଟୁ ଫାଇଣ୍ଡ ଦି ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟାଲ ପ୍ରୋସେସ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଓଡ଼ିଶା ସୋ ଆଇ ହୋପ୍ ହିଜ୍ ଓନ୍ ଫିଲ୍ଡ ଅଫ୍ ମାଇଗ୍ରେସନ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ୱାଟ୍ ଇ କଲ୍ ଦି ରିଅଲ୍ କାଇଣ୍ଡ ଅଫ୍ ରିହାବିଲିଟେସନ୍ ଇଜ୍ ୱାନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଦି ଫୋକସ୍ ଏରିଆ ୱାଇଲ୍ ଡିସ୍କସିଂ ଅନ୍ ସଚ୍ କାଇଣ୍ଡ ଅଫ୍ ଇସ୍ୟୁଜ୍ ଇନ୍ ରୁରାଲ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଅର୍ବନ୍ ଇଣ୍ଡିଆ ସାର୍ ସାର୍ ବିହାର ନେକ୍ସଟ କ୍ୱେଶ୍ଚନ୍ ହାଉ ଏନ୍ଜିଓ ଇଜ୍ ହେଲ୍ପଫୁଲ୍ ଇନ୍ ରୁରାଲ୍ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ
Now, basically, like NGOs have emerged for developing either human development or the rural development through education, through providing health support, awareness building. And I think we need to understand there are certain physical work government do, setting up hospitals, setting up schools and everything. The human resources are important. Because those people who will actually access these services, they need to be educated. Because our mass in a rural area, they doesn't know about various facilities, like no various kind of entitlement they have. Bartaman jo entitlement apno aji kali kahibe je jone quarantine center re rahile se kon kon paibo. So government has already declared at the state. But a person who is coming from abroad, baharu asibo, taku dinuku 120 tanka milibo. ତାକୁ 150 ଟଙ୍କା ମିଳିବ ଯଦି ସେ କିଛି କାମ କରିବ ହି ୱିଲ୍ ଗେଟ୍ 300 ରୁପିଜ୍ ଟୁ ବାଇ ଅ ମାସ୍କ ଅର୍ ଅଦର ମାନେ ଯାହା ବି ସାନିଟାଇଜର ସେଗୁଡ଼ା ତାର ସେଲ୍ଫ ସାନିଟାଇଜର ଆଇ ଗିଭ୍ ଏନ୍ ଏକ୍ସାମ୍ପଲ୍ ଆଣ୍ଡ ଆଫ୍ଟର କମ୍ପ୍ଲିସନ୍ ଅଫ୍ ହିଜ୍ 21 ଡେଜ୍ ଆଜି 21 ଡେଜ୍ ହେଇଯାଇଛି ଆଜି 28 ଡେଜ୍ ହେଇଛି 21 ଡେଜ୍ରେ କମ୍ପ୍ଲିଟ୍ କଲା ପରେ ତାକୁ 2000 ଟଙ୍କା ମିଳିବ ନା ଦୁଇ ହଜାର ଏଇଟା ହେଉଛି ଗୋଟେ ଆମର ଏଣ୍ଟାଇଟଲମେଣ୍ଟ ୱି କଲ୍ ଇଟ୍ ଏଜ୍ ଏନ୍ ଏଣ୍ଟାଇଟଲମେଣ୍ଟ ତାହେଲେ ଏଇଟା ତାଙ୍କୁ କିଏ କହିବ ଗଭର୍ଣ୍ଣମେଣ୍ଟ ତ କହିଦେଲେ ନୋଟିଫାଏ କରିଦେଲେ ପୋଷ୍ଟର ଲଗେଇଦେବେ ପଞ୍ଚାୟତରେ ଲୋକେ ବୁଝନ୍ତୁ ନ ବୁଝନ୍ତୁ ତାହେଲେ ସେ କ୍ୱାରେଣ୍ଟାଇନ୍ ସେଣ୍ଟର ଆଜି ଏଇ ସବଜେକ୍ଟ ଅଛି ସେଥିପାଇଁ ମୁଁ କହୁଛି ତାକୁ ବୁଝେଇବ କିଏ ତାକୁ ତ କିଏ ତ ବୁଝେଇବ ସେ କାମ କରିବ କିଏ ତେଣୁ ସରକାର କହନ୍ତି କି NGO ମାନେ କୁହନ୍ତୁ ତାଙ୍କର କମ୍ୟୁନିକେସନଟା ଭଲ ସେମାନେ ଲୋକଙ୍କୁ ସେଇଭଳିଆ ଭାବରେ ତେଣୁ ରୁରାଲ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ ମାନେ କ'ଣ ରୁରାଲ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ ମାନେ ଆମେ କହୁଛୁ ଖାଲି ସ୍କୁଲ ଘର ହେଇଗଲା ରାସ୍ତା ହେଇଗଲା ଦିଜ୍ ଆର୍ ଅଲ୍ ଫାଇନ୍ ଦିଜ୍ ଆର୍ ପାର୍ଟ ଅଫ୍ ରୁରାଲ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ ବଟ୍ ଦ ହ୍ୟୁମାନ୍ ଡେଭଲପମେଣ୍ଟ ହ୍ୟୁମାନ୍ କ୍ୟାପିଟାଲ ଯୋଉଟା ଅଛି ତାକୁ ଯଦି ଇଫ୍ ୟୁ ଆର୍ ନଟ୍ ୟୁଟିଲାଇଜିଂ ଦାଟ ସୋ ଅଲ୍ ଦିସ୍ ଫେସିଲିଟିଜ୍ ଦାଟ ୟୁ ଆର୍ ପ୍ରୋଭାଇଡିଂ ଇଜ୍ କମ୍ପ୍ଲିଟଲି ୟୁଜଲେସ୍ ପିପୁଲ ୱିଲ୍ ନଟ୍ ଆଇ ୱେଣ୍ଟ ଟୁ ସି ସମ୍ ଅଫ୍ ଦ ଏରିଆ ଯୋଉଠି ବହୁତ ଗୁଡ଼ାଏ ସ୍ୱଚ୍ଛ ଭାରତ ପରେ ଏ ଲେଟ୍ରିନ୍ ଗୁଡ଼ା ତିଆରି ହେଇଛି ଗୋଟେ ଜାଗାରେ ଦେଖିଲି ସେ ଲେଟ୍ରିନ୍ରେ ସେ ଗୁହାଳ କରିକି ରଖିଛି ଟ୍ରାଇବାଲ୍ ଏରିଆରେ ୟୁ ନୋ ୱାଇ because we have not done the need ki taku bujhei chu na nahi bhai amar target thila ame pos telu ngo mankor jo critical role ochi to bridge ei jo gap ochi government ro service re aur lokon ko jodiba sei ta hochu a major kaam aji jai darkar kali bhi darkar aur sei kaam ta jodi thik re hobo if they are going to do it well I think we will have a better development practices telu there is a role that NGOs can play, not only NGOs, our youth clubs can play, SHG can play. Two things, what are economic well-being, agote hela tanko society can se mane kaam karibe. Tenu dita re how NGOs are actually going to play a role, that is very important. Yeah,
thank you,
sir. I thought, I think I answered, I don't know. Whether.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much, sir. Sir, also we are having with us one of the principals of DAV school from Chhattisgarh. Sir Pachari Chandi, what are the scope for NGO after COVID-19? Rather, I should say this is not the scope. Rather, this should be in the form of moral responsibility because NGOs have having sufficient amount of scope, whether it is COVID or there is no COVID. So, moral responsibility to ask the NGO manan karo COVID pore. Sir, kindly sir, take it.
COVID is very unprecedented kind of no disaster that we are looking at. These are not a very natural kind of disaster we see all the time. The impact is much more than any disaster that India we have seen today, or the globe, or internationally or globally that we have ever experienced such a huge kind of no human misery. Very difficult to say that what NGOs can play a role, but how we all as a society can actually play that role, because the government people are actually on the ground. I actually salute them the way they are working. The health workers or the people who are on the, they are actually trying to fight this. They are the very warriors. And NGOs are also playing a little bit of role here and there. We know all the stranded laborers, various laborers, they got stranded in different places after the 24th lockdown. I remember that we reached out to large number of laborers through telephones, connecting them with NGOs. We have formed a large kind of national network to reach out to these people who needed some help. So we as an organization, we reached out to around 5,000 such laborers all over. There are some Jharkhand laborers were there, Chhattisgarh laborers were there, Odisha laborers were there. We could able to prevent many laborers who were actually working on the road, which just persuade that you stay back, don't work, because it's not the time that you can work. Counseling provided. And we work very closely with the government here, the State Disaster Management Authority. I think we have provided what can be done. Particularly, I have provided kind of how we are going to actually reach out to a large number of migrants, what would be their number, and when they are coming back, what are the things can be done. So it's a consultative kind of thing. And even government also consulted how to run a quarantine center. What can we do if there are children? What can we do if there are women in the quarantine center? What are the key things that the government has to do? So directly, I know we all, like you, we are also like at home, hardly we are getting any time to work. But today only the government people are actually on the ground, they're working. But we are working through different processes to strengthen the government initiative. We don't have any our own initiative today. We want to strengthen. We are coming up with a larger IEC material, information, education, communication material for creating awareness to children, to people. We have formed virtual community volunteers around in Bolangir, Nuapada, Bargad, around 500 virtual volunteers who could reach out to the community. So there are work, but we have limitations, even a lot of limitation. With that limitation, we are working, and hopefully we all have to work together, everyone. I think this is a crisis, and I don't know how to tackle it, but yes, we will overcome. That's the hope that we have. Yeah.
Really, sir, while answering this question, I was thinking ki each and every individual or the institution have been scattered and thrilled in this situation of this pandemic COVID-19. So every day or the other day, we are having guidelines, we are having plannings, we are having monitoring system to make some amount of what you call develop the planning or the scope for each and every activity. So really, till date, we are not finalized, we are not authorized to have such kind of specific guideline to work out in such a manner. Therefore, what we have said is a real case. We should work together. We should try to help each other, and every organization should work or think about other organizations. For example, let me also clarify, people with the migration, people with the non-governmental organizations have thought to have some support for the educational institutions by this kind of lecture is going on. So everyone has to give some amount of support for the real kind of development.
Right, I think today evening I'm going to talk to a virtual kind of basically talk on this migration issue and COVID-19 that's being organized by KISS today at 5 o'clock. Yeah, this is a huge humanitarian issue. I don't know. Yes, we are concerned about large number of people coming back to Odisha, how they will be provided support in a dignified way, and how they will also help each other. So a lot of challenges like Chhattisgarh, Jharkhand, Orissa, Bihar, Uttar Pradesh are the state which are actually receiving large number of laborers, poor people coming back to their state. And they are these are the migrant workers who are building India. Yeah. So someone has to build their lives. They have built everything in India. They are the poor migrant worker. I think now the challenge is how actually we will have a social integration, dignified integration in our society, and their health and livelihood is also important. Yes.
Sir, one of our learners, he's also with the Odisha Livelihood Mission as a nutrition specialist. So he's asking, we have not listened about migrant workers issue. I think he has some idea about that. We have not learned about the problems or the prospects to be gathered for these people of different states, those who have tried to visit Odisha, or those who have trying to get back to the state of Odisha in the form of reverse migration. So I think he's talking about we have not listened about migrant workers issue.
In the COVID response or this context?
Yes, I think so.
Look, yes, because even Government of India didn't know such a huge number of migrants would be there. When they announced the lockdown, let me say that they never realized migration problem is so huge in India. I think we don't have a database. We don't know how many people have migrated from Orissa. We don't know where they are. We don't know which sector they are working. Even those receiving state doesn't know, not registered. We have a law to register migrant worker. It was flouted. And when the crisis came, we all actually started responding to it. And we never actually responded to the problem. There is a structural issues why people have migrated out. I think that somewhere we need to answer why these people have moved out, such a large number from a state. Yes, certainly migration is a fundamental right also. If you are moving, I can also moving. If I'm moving, let the poor person should move. But the poor person should not move under distress. That's what we have been saying. If the distress condition somebody is moving, that's a state responsibility. And when now the crisis is that, yes, we underestimated the issues. And now I think it's a huge challenge before all of us, particularly the government, to actually get all the migrants. And also in this time of crisis, how we are going to protect the lives and livelihoods of all these people.
Yes, sir. What you have said is very much perfect, sir. We should not think about this kind of distress migration, because migration is okay, fine. But when you talk about distress migration, it is coming into the folds of state, because there are also some kind of intellectual migration in the form of brain drain to other countries, to other states. So it is okay, fine. They have seen the opportunity in different parts of the world. They have moved there, representing the country or the state. But this kind of distress migration is having much more implication for the, what you call, the responsibility of the state. Sir, there is another question. What is the difference between a trust and a foundation?
Yeah, foundation is mostly like, you know, today most of the corporates are actually naming some organization, and they also registered under the Trust or Society Act. But this is a foundation, mostly they registered that under Society Act, under the Trust Act. Basically, foundation in the name of someone, in memory of someone, or mostly the corporates are coming up with a foundation. This foundation doesn't have its own kind of, you know, registration body. Either they have to register under Company Act 25 section, or Society Act, or Trust Act. So trust, society, and company, they are all actually statutory requirement. But foundation is basically like, you know, people registered. Like you can name also foundation for ecological support. You can name. But largely the big corporates are actually coming up with a foundation. I don't see much of a difference between these two. One is a statutory, another is simply a name. Yeah.
Yes, sir. The next question is, maximum NGOs are working on project work. Very negligible are working on research and studies. Is it true? If yes, why we don't have any NGOs, those who are working on research or studies in undivided KBK? So he has this question with regards to this, sir, KBK, reflecting the financial and social conditions of those 8 districts.
Let me see that. Where is it basically why we are not getting into research, or that the question?
He means to say that there are NGOs, those who are working on different project works, and out of all such NGOs, it is very difficult to find out those who are working on research and studies. And out of them, there are least number of NGOs, those who are working on undivided KBK.
Yeah, I think, this is an area of concern. Even NGOs specialized in research are less in number. Very few organizations are actually working on research. And those who are actually coming up with research, there are two kinds of research. One is the action research, and another, Dr. Rehman can say, the academic research that we do generally. So the action research, many of us, we are good in that. This action research actually helping people sometime to see that what is happening right now in the community and what need to be done. Recently, I think for the NGOs, we have done a quick assessment about the COVID, its impact. Within 20 days, we could able to gather a quick kind of assessment. We have recently done, together with all the NGOs working in Orissa, what is happening to food insecurity, what's happening to the water and sanitation, what's happening to the women, children affected by COVID. So we gathered information immediately. So small samples we have taken, and quick kind of, you know, data event, what you can see. These are the things we are doing. But longer term, like, you know, studies which are required in KBK district, like, you know, it requires better, I think, the research which Dr. Rehman can say, a good research is required. I haven't come across any such good research still yet, looking into deeper into the crisis, deeper into the poverty, deeper into the hunger, deeper into the migration issue that we're talking about. We have done quite a lot studies in a couple of states. But yes, that's a need. And all NGOs are not expertise on this, doing this thing. They are more into mobilization, more into working with the community. Yeah.
Yes, sir. Really, sir. It's a very genuine question, sir, what you have said, sir. Because my area of study, PhD, is on KBK. This is of we're talking about Kalahandi, Bolangir, Koraput, and we're also including the other 5 districts. In totality, we're having 8 districts. It was in the year 1990 when a mother sold a child with rupees 2 rupees only. So this has shown that there is some amount of poverty-stricken area in the entire country, and at that time this Balangir was considered to be one of the most poverty-stricken zone in the entire country, and therefore, while discussing on Bimaru states of a concept of planning commission, at that time they have not included Odisha other than this Bihar, Madhya Pradesh, and Rajasthan and Uttar Pradesh. They have not included Odisha because Odisha was there not in terms of health problem, rather it is in the terms of poverty. So poverty was there, extraordinary poverty was there. And for this purpose, sir, you must be knowing that the Government of India, Planning Commission of India, has provided long-term action plans, funding huge amount of money to this portion of KBK. And further, they have also initiated to support the revised long-term action plan. But the problem lies with us, the complete state machinery, that we are unable to focus on our priorities. We are unable to make out proper indicators. What are our priorities and where should we put our money for real kind of development? And that was the precarious condition, that all the funds which have been supported from the central government were returned, and it was considered to be around 333 crores were returned to the national exchequer once again from Odisha.
Mm-hmm.
These are the problems, sir. Sir, one of the next learner, he has asked very pertinent question. Asked me very pertinent question about what are the areas to help return migrants recently came to Odisha. So he means to say this reverse migration. He is saying what are the areas or where we could help these reverse migrants, those who have recently came to Odisha.
Yeah, this is actually, I would say, is a reverse distress migration. Reverse migration always be used for positive kind of thing. Because those people who migrated coming back to their homeland because something development has brought them back. No? So again, they're re-migrating back to their villages. It's a good kind of, we always say reverse migration in a very positive term. And this reverse migration is a distress. People are moving back with distress. You have seen their pictures every day, how they're coming back, why they're coming back. And it's a major challenge that I always say. Two issues, I could say, these are the issues that the reverse migrant want. Or three issues, I can say. One is the kind of respect that we have to give them. I think that is first. They are actually coming back, and the kind of stigma they're undergoing. Both gare loko bada pokai dechante man asile. Nostra ejiwa gaan. Imane untouchables, the new untouchables that I could see now, which I'm writing now. Imanta asibe, tankar bi adhikar achi gaan re. The second issue is their health. Jibon. Lives. Titaku kemti ame dekhi pariba. Gotela dignity. Second is their life. Third is livelihood. Is a livelihood, imani feruchanti, they lost everything at their place of work. And they are coming penniless. They don't have anything in their hand. Yes. So it's their health, their dignity, their health, and their livelihood is matters. How we are going to actually work on that. So that is what I would say. These three areas are more important today for the migrant who are returning back.
Really, sir. Sir, thank you very much. Either I should also say, sir, what sir has suggested, it is in the form of the basic fundamentals we have to take care. What he has introduced, this concept of what is called respect. So suddenly it has come to my mind that we should have 3 R's to be taken care of for the people, those who are returning back. One should be respect, and second should be the resilience. We should have resilience to accept them. We should have a proper sense of respect for them to accept. And third is responsibility. We should also inculcate some amount of responsibility within us, so that we should create some opportunity for their social and economic status to be built up. Really, sir, thank you very much, sir.
Yes, you're right.
Next question is, how far the NGOs have able to control migration in Western Odisha?
I think it's a very good question. We are like, you know, always we think two things. Like, people have a right to migrate and people should not migrate in distress. These two are important to understand. Western Odisha, people are migrating due to distress, mass distress, drought, destitution and debt. Drought, destitution and debt. This 3D is actually pushing people out. So when people are moving out, NGOs do not have that much of resources to actually feed them. They may reach out to a few here and there. In fact, we are working with 1,200 legally released bonded laborers who migrated, were kept as hostage. They were released by government, and we have actually started supporting them. Like, out of these 1,200 people, 70% people have stayed back in village. They're not migrating because of the various livelihood kind of. 30% people are still migrating. And they'll migrate because they have a skill, they have expertise, and they'll migrate. But they have to migrate with information. Suchana neki jibe, asibe. So we are working on that. It's a huge issue. Whoever friend has actually asked this question, I think I can speak it for hours on this issue because this is my subject. I can tell you longer, and I can also discuss with you. But yes, in nutshell, I want to say this. This is a collective work that need to be done with government and civil society doesn't have much resources and expertise or area to work. They have to work closely with the government, and government has to create that mission mode. E jagare ame etiki migration komai dabu 5 barsha bhitare dadano sampurna hotei dabu Odisha ru. If this comes in, then government will ask everyone, please come, we'll have a 10 years agenda to do this. That's not happening.
This kind of migration is not, you can specify with Western Odisha. Sir, any part of the state, this Northern Odisha,
yes.
Migration, distress migration, habata itte problem creating hazelani. People coming from Surat through Ganjam, it is this particular the Southern Odisha. This has made a UN cry in the state regarding COVID-19. So, yesterday our developmental process is specific zone-wise. Rather, we have to think in a broader sense. Really, it's a difficult task. So, thank you very much for your kind support. Sir, kisi learner apne bahut learner sir, thank you janu chanti plus jone likhi chanti ki can umi sir ankaro jo email id amko share karibe. Yes, I will share the email id of sir karo. And sir, with due respect and with your permission, can we have your presentation? Since we are recording then we will also upload your presentation in the...
I'll send you. Yes. I'll do.
All the
sir, it's my pleasure. I think people should know. I think whatever little I said, I think it is useful. Yeah, definitely I'll share it. And thank you all for your patience listening. And we'll interact more on development issues. Yeah.
And for all the learners, once again, if you want to see more interactive sessions without asking questions, please watch OTV after 7 p.m. prime
time. No, I'm not regular. Not regular. Yesterday I was there in Janmanch, but sometime I come. I'm not a regular. But yes, they call me on certain issues. But I will send you my article, recent article, 4 or 5. I write for Down to Earth most of the time. And I'll be sending it to you, Dr. Rehman. Please send that because this is an issue concerning migration. And I'll be very happy to share my write-ups. Yes, thank you.
Colleague, one of my colleagues is saying, ki, sir, we are looking forward. That means they are also expecting for more sessions with you, so that we can definitely finalize with your ease and with your comfort. So thank you very much, sir. I was almost on road to feedback from the HMA, Nishant Patichandji, kindly fill up for you. So thank you very much, sir. We will be in touch with you, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Samastha, kindly. Samastha, off currency, new currency, customer value currency. Our official, you can declare it has been completed. We have closed. Thanks a lot. Thanks.